This is Nicole Holland of the Business Building Rockstar Show, and you are listening to episode 38.
You're listening to the Business Building Rockstar Show, where your host, Nicole Holland, gets the lowdown from today's most talented, inspiring, and successful entrepreneurs on what it really takes to reach rockstar status.
You want to get your message out in a bigger way by being a guest on a web show or podcast just like this? If you do, text the letters I am ready to 33444, and I will send you free of charge a guide called How to Be a Great Guest. Don't make rookie mistakes that so many people do when they're starting out. Get known as a great guest that hosts search for free by texting I am ready to 33444. So to spell that out, it's the letters I am R E A D Y to 33444. And I will send you a complimentary copy of my guide, How to Be a Great Guest. On today's episode, Brian Basilico of the Bacon Podcast and I hang out and talk about how to create a buzz before your book even comes out. Brian shares with me his first major computer lesson, what made him decide to become an author, and his take on the two basic purposes of social media. Without further delay, let's get right into it. Hey there, entrepreneur. Welcome to the Business Building Rockstar Show. I'm hanging out today with Brian Basilico. I am super, super excited to have Brian with us here today. He is the internationally recognized best-selling author of It's Not About You, It's About Bacon, Relationship Marketing in a Social Media World. And he's got another book coming up soon called The Bacon System, Marketing Recipes for a Sizzling Business. He's a highly sought-after speaker, coach, and adjunct professor, and brings over 35 years of marketing experience to his award-winning internet marketing company, B2B Interactive Marketing, Inc. Brian is also a syndicated podcaster, blogger, and a regular guest expert featured in Entrepreneur and Inc. magazines, on radio shows, and of course, podcasts. Brian, welcome to the Business Building Rockstar Show.
What up, Nicole?
Hey. So thank you so much for being here. I gave our listeners a little bit of a high-level overview. Why don't you fill in the blanks and let us know what you're up to these days?
Oh, yeah. Well, there's lots of blanks. So, I'm up to a lot of different things. I mean, I'm doing a lot of online marketing, a lot of training, helping companies and people understand how to use online marketing better, especially, I mean, the whole Bacon System book is based on stuff that I've taught people over the last handful of years, 2-3 years, that's really helped them like double and triple their business. And I'm not kidding. I mean, I'm talking about, you know, six-figure businesses doubling their income. So it's huge. But the whole purpose of all of this stuff is to really understand content marketing, online marketing, and measurement, and understanding how all that works to help promote business.
That's fantastic. So how did you get into this? How long have you been doing this for yourself?
Well, let me give you the long story and try to shorten it up. I started back in I'm not even going to give the year. A long time ago, I built a recording studio in my dad's basement. And so I was living at home at the time. Did that for a long time and then ended up getting a job at AT&T, started to learn how to shoot and edit video and produced videos and did some award-winning work there. Left that company, started a commercial recording studio and did that for about 8 years. And we did jingles, True Value Hardware, Tiger Toys, all the cassettes for Avon Ladies, and started getting into some multimedia programming. Ultimately sold that company to a production company where I did websites, flash animation, more CD-ROM programming. Left there and went to work for Arthur Anderson in their training division. And there I was doing some high-level, again, video programming, all that kind of stuff. Went to work for an ad agency, and there I was doing Google AdWords and website development and online marketing and all of that kind of stuff. And then ultimately this business, B2B Interactive Marketing, took off in 2001. So I've been doing this for over 16 years and been focusing, primarily when I first started out in this business, I was building business card CDs. And there was no Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter. There was no social media. And then it slowly evolved into, you know, more of the complete online marketing and using social media marketing. And now that's specifically what I'm doing and teaching people now.
That is so cool. So you're really on the cutting edge of the boom in the internet age and online marketing space.
Yes. Yeah. No, I was doing, I was one of the early adopters of You've Got Mail. So,
yeah, you know, we had, so that was AOL, right?
Right. Exactly.
Do you remember Prodigy?
I do. I remember it well.
My dad was a computer engineer. So we had, you know, all stuff that nobody even, like, people are like, what, you know, computers? And I remember the, playing games with the cursors, you know.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Pong. I mean, remember Pong?
I don't remember this. I remember there was some game about, like, some trail. Like, you had, like, going out west or something.
And, oh, yeah. Oregon Trail.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, and I don't know. I can't remember other games, but, you know, I've been around for a while too, so.
Yeah, but one of my favorite computer stories, I bought, I was really an early adopter with computers, and I bought an Atari 400.
Yes!
And so I bought this Atari 400, and I had this magazine, and it was how to write in programming, you know, so I was learning how to program the thing. And I literally spent 8 hours writing a program that all it did was show the American flag. That's all it was. It's like, on your TV, you get to see the American flag. Only one problem. There was no storage device for it at all. So I programmed the thing, and I'm looking at it going, God, this is great, but I got to save it somehow. So I went up to the local mall, and I bought a floppy disk drive for my Atari 400, which was at the time was like $400 for a floppy drive for a little mini computer. So I bought it. I come home, getting ready to plug it in, and I looked down at my computer, and it was turned off.
And
I looked at my father and I said, Dad, what happened? He says, it was wasting electricity. So I learned a very valuable lesson that day.
Backing up is important.
Yeah, so having something to save to is important.
Yeah, for sure.
My first major computer lesson.
Yeah. Oh my gosh, this just brings back so many memories. And I think of the Atari and sitting in the TV room with my brother, and, you know, all the neighborhood kids would, like, come over to play because they didn't have one.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, we were a computer family, I guess. Okay, well, memory lane. So thinking of childhood, how about you? Like, what did you want to be when you were really young? You started doing this recording stuff pretty early, but when you were really little, was there something different you had in mind?
Oh, yeah. When I was little, you know, I grew up in the 60s, so I wanted to be an astronaut. That was my goal. But that wasn't going to happen. And then at age 10, I wanted to be a musician, hence how I started the whole recording studio thing. And I thought I was going to be a rock and roll star. But I had neither the talent nor the looks nor the connections to make that happen. So my degree is actually in electronics. And so I did an electronic technician degree, thinking that if I couldn't be in a band, I could roadie for bands and fix their amps. That didn't happen either. So.
And here, look at you now.
Yeah.
So similar, though, in some ways. You may not be a musician rock star, but you're a rock star in every other sense of the word, and you're
so sweet. Well, I do still play. I mean, I'm still a musician. I mean, I play at church. I was in a two-man acoustic band for 15 years, and, you know, so I still love doing that. It's just, you know, never really made a living doing it. That was the biggest difference.
Right on. I gotcha. So tell me about, like, when you decided to build this recording studio in your dad's basement, like, what sparked that? Was it just because you thought, well, I want to be a musician, so this is going to be for me? Or did you, like, how did you get into that? And then next would be, did you make money from that?
Oh, yeah. Actually, it started when I had a band in high school, and I had this huge PA system, you know, with big speakers and mixing boards and all this other stuff. And this was the time when 4-track cassette recorders were coming out. So meaning they would take a normal cassette has 4 tracks on it. It's got 2 going one way in stereo and 2 going the other way in stereo. And so the first, you know, little mini digital recorders, it wasn't even digital at the time, it was an audio cassette recorder, would record all 4 tracks. So I went out and dropped, you know, I think at the time it was like $1,500 and bought one of those, plugged it into all the gear I had and started inviting other bands coming in. And then they started paying me like $5 an hour. And I'm going, wow, this is cool. People are going to pay me to play with my equipment. So, and then, you know, slowly but surely the prices went up when I got better gear and, you know, bought an 8-track, not like the 8-track you plug in your dash, but a reel-to-reel that would record 8 tracks at a time. And started doing more complex stuff and started doing some radio commercials and stuff like that. And I said, wow, this is pretty cool. I'm really digging, you know, the musical tie-in. And you know, I had enough musical knowledge that I was a really good recorder and editor and things like that. And, you know, those skills, I mean, I still use them today on my podcast. You know, that's why I love podcasting, because it's congruous with everything that I've done from, you know, day one.
That's so fantastic. So cool. So Let's talk about your books, because the podcasting then is a natural progression, obviously. And then you've gone through, you know, multimedia and websites and ad agencies, and you've done the online thing. And so you've got all this experience that has beautifully wrapped up into what you now do. Now let's talk about those specifically, the book. What made you decide to become an author on top of it, everything else?
Well, I mean, the first book was, I decided I wanted to, because social media was so relatively new, it was such a hot topic, I decided I want to write a book about social media. And I started co-writing it with a friend who's a blogger. And we got about through chapter 3, and everything we had written at the time was completely obsolete by chapter 3, because things changed that fast. So I decided to kind of venture off on my own and write a why-to book and not a how-to book. And so the first book, it's not about you, it's about Bacon, Relationship Marketing in a Social Media World, was really about why you should be doing this. And the foundation of it is, in the first chapter I talk about this, one of the first jobs I had was working at a shoe store. And we used to keep people's names on these little metal plates. And we'd have those plates made, and then when it was time for them to get new shoes, we had postcards, and we'd run it through a machine and put it in the mail. And it was all about building relationships at the time. And I learned, you know, at a very early age at working, you know, I think I was 15 at the time, you know, working in a store, how to build relationships and build a tribe with people. And that's what the whole book was about, was just figuring out, you know, ways that let's put it this way, the technology changes, but the methodology has never changed. Marketing is still marketing. Relationships are still relationships. And that's the cornerstone of everything that we do. I mean, being online and just sitting here and posting, you know, ad after ad after ad doesn't really do a whole lot to get people to know, like, and trust you. And that's what the book is about, is really spending time to develop those relationships to the point where people are either going to purchase directly from you, or they're going to recommend you to somebody when they know that somebody needs your services or your products. So that was the first thing that I decided to do. And actually, it was a culmination of blogs that I've written. I decided to take all these blogs and repurpose them into this book, but I literally rewrote it. And it was 300 pages. It was quite the experience. It's self-published. And when I did it, I didn't realize anything about book publishing. I didn't know anything about marketing a book. But I did know enough that I needed help, because my nickname is Captain Typo. I suck at writing. my spelling is bad, my grammar is bad, and that will never change, because that's just me. You know, it's like I'm never going to be a person who understands. I could look at a book and read the same chapter 15 times and not be able to pick out any of that stuff. So what I did is I hired an editor, I hired a proofer, I hired a designer who designed the cover. I hired somebody to design the inside. I actually had to hire an indexer. I didn't know there was no software that can create an index. You have to hire somebody to read the entire book and put the, okay, this word is on this page, because software cannot tell the difference between Google Analytics, Google Business, Google Plus, or Google. It needs to know what each one of those mean. And if you're going to index those kind of things, somebody's physically got to read it and map it all out for you. So it was a huge undertaking. The other thing I didn't know about it was that I thought, okay, I'm going to write this book and I'm going to become rich. You know what the average person sells as far as if they do a self-published book?
Not very much.
I've heard two different things. I've heard it from two different people. It's either 10 or 150.
Yeah.
Now, I spent $5,000 developing that book. So my goal, and I make, you know, on average about $7.50 a book. That's the nice thing about self-publishing. If you go through somebody who's, you know, like a regular publishing company, you'll make $1 a book. And but self-publishing, you're going to make a little bit more. So through speeches and stuff like that, my goal was to sell 500 books to make $10 a piece so I could break even. I've sold 2,500, so I've made a little bit of money, but it's not going to make my mortgage payment.
Yeah, that's so cool. Now, how long did it take you from the time that you got clear on this vision of what you were going to do and you started compiling the blog post? How long did it take you from that point to actually have it out there and published?
It took about 6 months. And luckily at the time I was working with a coach who had written a handful of books, and she really kind of guided me through the process in understanding, you know, how to build a buzz before the book came out, you know, create web pages, blog about it, you know, do get as many interviews as you could ahead of time. So writing the book itself probably took about 4 months, and there was 2 months in prep time to get it to launch. And so that was the first book, and that took, you know, it took a while. The second book that I wrote, I actually did intentionally. It's called It's Not About You, It's About Bacon Bits, 101 Relationship Marketing Tips. And what I did on that one is, as I was writing the other book and actually going through the process, I decided to blog from January to December 31st, 365 daily blogs of about 50 words. That whole blog was designed to be the second book. And I knew that's what it was going to be. So I blogged every single day. And when it was all said and done, I had 365 blogs to choose from, narrowed it down to the top 101, and basically created a little mini 6x6 book that was a giveaway at the same time. That one obviously took a lot less to do. I mean, it took a year to get the content, but, you know, to push the book out and develop it, that took, you know, like about 2 months to really make happen.
Cool. So now you've learned so much. So tell me about, how is it that you're doing things different with the Bacon System, Marketing Recipes for a Sizzling Business?
Okay. So this one is another, you know, success story, at least the way I call it a success story. I actually have a group coaching system that I put together, and it's based on what I've taught other people to do. And it really boils down to three concepts. There's what I call the marketing trifecta, and the marketing trifecta is having a killer website, understanding analytics, and the content marketing, and having those three things working in concert. So part one is understanding that core system that you need. Part two is content development. And it's like blogging, podcasting, video, creating lead magnets, doing things that you're generating content with a purpose so that you can draw people into your marketing trifecta and get value from it. Part three is what I call content delivery. And this was really a big aha. I used to think that social media was an end-all be-all. What I realized it has two basic purposes. Number one is to build and generate relationships. And two is to deliver content. So you're creating this content, you need a platform to deliver it. So that's where email marketing, Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, Pinterest, Instagram, Snapchat, all of those things are a place to disseminate your content. And also using things like groups and Facebook and LinkedIn and things of that nature. And then the final piece is repurposing it so that you can take a video that you do, turn it into a podcast, turn that into something that's transcribed, and turn it into an ebook. And that's what the whole system is built on. And it's a 12-week system. So back to your original question, so you understand the big picture, is I created the entire course and had all 12 modules ready to go. And instead of writing a book about what I did, what I literally did was take the modules, take the PowerPoints that I had, plugged in my headset into my Mac, and basically read through each one of those training modules. And so I took that, sent it off to an editor, she edited it down, sent it off to a proofer, and literally within a month, I wrote a 200-page book.
Yeah, and I want to really just stop here for a moment and highlight this for our listeners. Mm-hmm. You know, if you are thinking about that you would like to write a book one day, especially if we're talking about a nonfiction book, a how-to book, something that you're an expert at, that you're skilled at, and you're thinking that becoming an author would be a fantastic thing, like, go back and listen to that bit again, because that is it. Like, you have used a minimal amount of time to get the biggest impact. And so I think a lot of things that I'll hear from people are things like, well, if I put everything from my program in a book, then people won't want the program. And I just don't agree with that. I mean, for example, you know, Ryan Dice has got the Invisible Selling Machine, and mm-hmm. just because the templates are in the book doesn't mean that people aren't going to want to go deeper and get into that program to get more information. It's like, yeah, I'm so excited to hear you talk about this. This is a fantastic nugget.
Yeah, and here's the thing that I had to overcome, because I thought the same thing when I first started writing. I don't want to give away everything. But I completely shifted my mindset. And this actually came from another coach I've been working with. I love coaches. I love coaching people, and I love coaches because they really get your mind straight. And one coach, his name is Bob Yeager, came to me and basically said, dude, he says, give away all your best stuff for free. The rest will come. So not only have I written the book and I've got it in a physical form, but I'm actually posting every one of the chapters as blogs on baconcoach.com. And I'm literally putting it up on LinkedIn, and all the slides for my program up on SlideShare. I'm giving the whole thing away for free, because what it does is it exposes people to the core concepts. But, you know, when it gets down to brass tacks, it's that one-on-one touch time that's really making a difference for clients. And that's where, you know, the bottom line is, what I am selling is the training and coaching. The book is a introduction to it. Even, you know, you could sit here and read the entire book, but you're still not going to get all the concepts. An example, I mean, I literally just got off a coaching call. I got 12 people in this group coaching, and one guy had a website and he wrote some books. And so it was his spotlight time. And yet he's been through this stuff with me. And I sat down and looked at his website and I said, dude, you're missing this, you're missing this, you're missing this. And he looked at it, and he says, wow, you're right. You know, and it was like an eye-opening experience, because sometimes you just need that personal input to help you see the forest from the trees. That's why I love coaches, because they get you to realize that, man, you know, giving this stuff away, you know, you're not going to get rich selling a book. So why not just put it out there? And if somebody wants to go through and read 12 blog posts, they'll do that. Or most people want to pick up a physical book, they'll go to Amazon and buy it, or they'll get it on Kindle. You know, but that is still I hate to put it this way, but it's kind of a gateway drug, you know, to getting people more interested in the benefits that you bring to them. You know, that's really what it boils down to.
Absolutely. And we each have such an individual voice that I totally agree, giving your best stuff away is like, if you want to reach any level of success, you have to. If you're hiding it, then nobody is ever going to know about you. So right. Even if you're the most brilliant person in the world, if you're, you know, sitting there and you're typing away and you're creating everything and nobody can know until it's done because they might steal it. Well, hey, you know what? Life has moved on. People have moved on. And the people who are generously sharing and enlightening people and supporting people because they can, and mm-hmm. not because they're getting paid, those are the people that then are going to reap the rewards of that. So I really love that we're talking about this. And I think too, it's important to mention, you know, how many times do we need to hear the same thing before it sinks in sometimes? Like mm-hmm. I'm 40 and, you know, I've been studying law of attraction for a really long time, and I've heard the same things and I've read the same things and I know the same things in my brain. But every single day I find more and more the experience that I'm going, oh my gosh, yes, okay, I get that now. I know this, you know, I know it, but now I know it. And that might sound really cryptic and weird to people, but it's so important that we get the information that we need over and over and over in different ways before it sinks in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, you know it, but now you embrace it. I mean, that's a big difference, is now it's a part of you. You know, and that's where it that takes time. And that, again, is where, you know, I've needed coaches to really pull things out of me. And that's one of the reasons, and I've kind of built my entire model on, hey, man, these people have changed my world. And I know I can do the same thing for other people, but you got to pay it forward first. And I'll give you another story on this. And this just happened today. So I was introduced to, and I don't know if you've ever done a thunderclap. Are you familiar with that?
Yes. Uh-huh.
Okay. So, you know, I was introduced to Thunderclap launching the book, and I went in individually and went into people in Facebook, and I messaged them and said, would you please join me on Thunderclap, help me promote the book? Goal is only to get 100 people to do that. I got thousands I'm sure I could tap into, but, you know, so I'm trying to get 100 people to do this. One of those people happens to be quite an influencer whose name is Warren Whitlock. I don't know if you know him or not, but he liked the way that I did it, and he actually got another thunderclap from somebody else at the same time on Twitter. He wrote a post about how I approached the thunderclap. And the first thing that he said is, this guy gives so much. He gives away all his information in his podcast. I've been interviewed by him. I see him helping other people. Yeah, I'm going to jump on board and try to help promote him. This other guy didn't know me from Adam. All he did was come on and say, promote my crap. And I wouldn't touch that with a 10-foot pole. So it was all that upfront work that I did that gets a huge influencer with 227,000 Twitter followers to say, I'm going to share your stuff. And it was all from the preemptive things that I did up front. You know, do you think that's going to help make my book a little bit more popular on launch day? I think so. What do you think?
Absolutely. And it's funny you mentioned that, because today I had a somewhat similar experience. You know, John Lee Dumas is a god in podcasting and one of my mentors. And he doesn't share people's stuff generally, not unless you're like in the club, like Pat Flynn or Amy Porterfield, you know, right. People that he's really close with.
Right.
And I logged into Twitter today and I saw that he did actually take it upon himself to share from his own, you know, from his own account about the show and about our interview from a couple weeks ago. And I just thought, that is flippin' cool. Like, and mm-hmm. that's what you're talking about there, is that relationship. And right. every day people are going to him and asking him to do things for them. And so the fact that he was willing to was pretty darn cool.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, you know, same thing. I mean, we got together on a blab and we talked in the blab about you and your relationship with John Lee Dumas. You gave me some insight on how to get a hold of him. And guess what? I've got him booked for the Bacon Podcast because of you, you know. That's so awesome. It's like, yeah, it's all that pay it forward stuff really does pay off. And
it's, I'm going to just stop you there, because it's interesting you say that, and I appreciate that, because that is really something I love doing. I love connecting people. I can't even count the number of people who I've been connecting. I like it. It's part of relationship building, but it's the part that really is joyful for me. Mm-hmm. And it takes no time at all if it's a right fit. Now, you asked me about John Lee Dumas. I gave you the information and it's like, no big deal. I've had people kind of cold email me and say, hey, you had John Lee Dumas on your show. Can you ask him to get on my show? Like,
right.
No, no. Why would you even think that that's appropriate? And we get these kinds of messages, I'm sure you do too, all the time, where people say, hey, you're doing something. Can you do this for me? And I'm thinking, you're not my client. You're not my friend. You're not a
right.
peer. You're not providing value to me. Just because I'm a generous person and I enjoy helping people doesn't mean that I'm going to help everyone in the world because they want me to.
Right. Oh, and the same thing with, you know, my podcast is people, you know, see the podcast, they see that it's ranking high, that it's getting, you know, thousands of visits a month. And they're just saying, hey, would you interview me? It's like, dude, I don't know you from Adam. You know, it's like, I'd love to interview you, but I don't know you. I don't know what you do. It's like, and you get these cold things all the time. That's one of the reasons why I started my blab show. I kind of call it my, training wheels for getting people on my show, because I've done some blabs with people who are wonderful, interesting people, but they're just not a good fit, you know, because they don't have a unique selling proposition and message. I mean, but it's getting those people out of the blue that just think, hey, I wrote a book. I want to be on your podcast. It's like, dude, you know, I don't know anything about you and I'm not here to promote you. Yeah. I'm here to educate my audience and meet influencers. That's the whole purpose of the podcast, is to give great content to people. I don't want to sit here and listen to a half hour sales pitch.
Yeah. And I think chemistry is important too.
Right.
And it's funny we're talking about this, because I'm actually in the process of creating a lead magnet. And then if people like it, which from what I'm hearing, this is what my people are asking for, I'm going to probably do a digital product on this by the time this episode airs, about how to be a great guest and how to get booked and why people will say yes to you. If you want to be on a podcast, if you want to be on blabs, if you want to be a guest, you got to have some stuff dialed in before you start reaching out, and the way you reach out and all that. So I've been, you know, in this time, I've really noticed, like, there are some people who are phenomenal guests and they have similar things going on. And there's some guests that I will not ask back again ever. So
sure.
I'm really excited to put that out. So just to let my audience know, you know, if that's interesting to you and you want to get a guide on how to be a great guest for free, you can text the letters I am ready. So that's, there's no A there. It's just I am READY to 33444. And I will get that to you.
Cool.
So, Brian, we are running out of time. Before we wrap up, do you want to let everybody know how they can reach you and how you can serve them and support them?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the simplest way is just go search Brian Basilico. It's BrianBasilico. Go search it on Google. You'll find tons of stuff. If you want to learn more about the Bacon Podcast, just go to baconpodcast.com. There's a lot of great interviews on there and more coming down the pike. And if you want to learn more about my books, it's notaboutyou.com, N-O-T-A-B-O-U-T, the letter U.com. And there you can find a page for the upcoming Bacon System and the other books that are out there. And, you know, I'd love to connect up with anybody. I mean, that's what it's all about. It's about relationships. And, you know, I'm here to help connect other people like you, Nicole, with people that I can as well. So this has been awesome.
Absolutely. I've had so much fun with you.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Well, I hope that we'll do this again real soon.
I hope so, too.
Hey, I hope you enjoyed today's episode. And if you did, make sure to subscribe on iTunes so that you don't miss another episode. And if you're just joining us for the first time, welcome. Thanks so much for being here. And if you want to catch up on past episodes, it's super easy to do when you subscribe on iTunes. Also, we're on Stitcher. And of course, you can visit bbrshow.com for all of the episodes, show notes, and more. I would love to hear what you think about today's episode by leaving a review on iTunes, or also you can go to bbrshow.com, and on our show notes page, there is a comment section. Dear listeners, I do this show for you. So the more you let me know what you love, the more I can bring you that. Don't forget that the Business Building Rockstar Show releases every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. So 3 times per week, you can listen in to what the journey towards rockstar status entrepreneurship is really like. Until next time, thanks so much for being here. I appreciate you, and I look forward to connecting again real soon.
And there you have it. If you enjoyed this episode of the Business Building Rockstar Show, be sure to subscribe on iTunes so you don't miss a thing.
And visit bbrshow.com for all the show notes and links to resources discussed on today's show.
Plus, lots more.